Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Let's start with Umul Kitab Al-Fatihah. A'udzu billahi minasy syaithanir rajim. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Arrahmanirrahim. Maliki yaumiddin. Iyyaka na'budu wa iyyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladzina an'amta 'alaihim ghairil maghdubi 'alaihim waladdallin. Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Alhamdulillahirrabbilalamin. Assalatu wassalamu ala sayyidil mursalin sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Allahumma aftah alayna futuhal arifin wa rizqana fahm an-nabiyyin wa hifdha al-mursalin wa ilham al-malaikat al-muqarrabin birahmatika ya arhamar rahimin ya arhamar rahimin ya arhamar rahimin. Wa sallallahu ala sayyidina Muhammadin wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa baraka wa sallam. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alamin. Alhamdulillah. Thank you guys for tuning in, for joining the class. Let me take the attendance. And kita sambung semalam sikit. And kita habis lah hari ni. Eh. Hari ni kita dah masuk chapter terakhir. So by right, hari Jumaat tu sama ada kita berkukuhkan lagi ataupun mungkin kalau tak habis semua pun hari Jumaat kita sambung. Kan hari Jumaat kan, hari ni hari Selasa ya. So hari Jumaat, and then by this Saturday kita dah boleh buat IRC dah. Like I told you, we will finish transfer pricing ataupun at least we'll get started, I hope, on transfer pricing today. And then by by Friday kan, by Friday we finish the chapter, and then hari Sabtu dah start IRC, which is your intensive revision class. Starting with that chapter yang kita baru habis, which is transfer pricing lah. I plan to do both section C dengan OTQ type of questions. Okay, eh? So maknanya guys, ibarat kita dah dengar, dia panggil apa eh? Bukan kompang kan, itu macam orang nak kahwin kan, nak kata kompang di Palu kan. Gendang ke apa, gendang di Palu. Menandakan perang dah dekat, iaitu pilihan raya kan. On our side, selain mengundi, kita juga nak mengundi ABCD nanti dalam your PM exam tu. So kita kena palu kompang jugalah. As in, I hope you are having that motivation and the feeling already that the exam is near. Okay, but insyaAllah, way to go. We have about 1 month, including I hope by December tu boleh buat some optional free classes for you. With that, I hope it will be good enough for you to pass. I hope lah, insyaAllah. But it will take a lot of effort. I don't think it's going to be easy, but kita akan cuba. Let's get started with Azim. Is Azim here? Today, I don't know, but anyway, just to make it formality. Excellent. Okay, thank you, Azim. So Azim is here. And then Aida. Thank you, Aida. Kita okay, ada two more people joining. Okay. Thank you, Aida. Amin.
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you, Amin. Fatin. Ada tak? Fatin ada. Yes, no. Fitri. Tapi belum kat Fatin. Fitri ada. Atau mungkin kita tak boleh dengar kot. Sometimes it could be the internet connection ke apa kan? Tak apa. Fitri, and then Mas Liza. Okay, Fatin dah ada dah. Okay. Thank you Fatin. Thank you Fitri. Mas Liza. Ada tak? I proceed dulu eh. Mungkin belum. Atau mungkin tak dengar kan? Kadang-kadang you off your speaker ke apa kan? Syazwan. Tu, okay, Mas Izzam mau masuk. Syazwan ada, thank you Syazwan. Saifuddin, tadi dengar suara Din. Thank you Din. Then Ain. Excellent, thank you Ain. Atika. Okay, thank you Atika. Nanti kita sambung. Itu ingat. Okay, tak apa nanti. Nanti kita sambung our discussion on your question, right? And then Ashikin. Thank you, hadir. Okay, sorry Mas Liza. I saw you entering just now. Thank you Mas Liza. Thank you Ashikin also. Aifah. Ifah, I think I owe you kan. Saya lupa terus dah. Soalan nanti kita tanya soalan relevant costing ya. Ingatkan saya balik nanti Ifah. Ifah ada tak? Okay, thank you Ifah. Ingatkan saya balik eh. I think I owe you. I think ada jawab soalan tapi ada yang lama dulu relevant costing. Kan nanti remind me again. Natasha. Okay, thank you Natasha. Sofia, Sofia ada tak? Ada semalam pun ada kan? I think I tak tanda sebab macam the rest Soleha dengan Fatin nanti I saw towards the end. Semalam Sofia ada tak? Do you remember? Tak, kalau ada I nak tanda.
Semalam saya tak join, so sorry.
Oh, okay, sure, tak apa. So, I letak as absent lah, boleh?
Okay.
Okay, eh? Tapi kalau you ada MC ke apa, you beritahu. Ataupun ada, like, I don't know, like urusan ke apa kan? I can consider putting with permission. I don't think you guys ada attendance problem pun everyone kan, all of you, sebab yelah kalau you, I tak tahulah you pernah dengar ke tak, kalau ada setengah orang like the whole semester tak datang, itu problem lah. Because again, I understand, I tak nak lah galakkan kan, I tak nak lah kita semua take it lightly kan, untuk tak datang ke lah, I tak nak lah macam tu, tapi at the same time, I do, I think, provide some allowance, if you will, for some absenteeism kan, I mean with valid excuses, so no worries. But nanti alamak I pun tak upload lagi tu kan. Sofia boleh refer kawan-kawan juga. Our aim guys eh, at the end of the day our aim adalah untuk belajar dan catch up and score in the exam itu. Macam tu eh. So what we miss in the past then we cover back. Macam itulah kan cara dia. Kalau kita ada objektif, matlamat yang clear, kita akan cuba dia macam mana pun. Itu in my mind macam itulah. Okay, anyway, Nisa. Okay, good. Kalau kita overseas kan dia tak kisah kan. Dia datang ke, dia pakai short ke kan. Tapi kira itu budaya dia orang. Kita orang Melayu, kita nak jaga juga attendance student sebagai satu motivasi. Dalam masa yang sama, because we believe it affects your result. So, lain lah, lain budaya. And anyway, Syahira. Okay, good. Thank you. Nisa, Syahira, Fasiha. Okay, good. And then Soliha. Okay, good. Zulaika. Okay, excellent. Thank you. Zulaika has asked a very good question through WhatsApp. And I believe, and I hope juga lah yang lain pun, again, you boleh tanyalah kawan-kawan ni yang suka tanya I. Mungkinlah I lambat juga jawab, tapi insyaAllah I'll try my best untuk jawab. So nak katanya, tanyalah soalan. I would be happy to answer. Nak katanya, it's going to be very good. Oh, okay. Noted, Sofia. Noted. Dan nanti I'll try to consider that juga eh. Sofia kan. Thank you, Sofia. Explain something to me. Okay, good eh. Macam contohnya, I share eh. Zulaika eh. Zulaika tanya tentang kenapa kena ada assumption dalam limiting factor analysis. Saya ingat kan OPP kan, optimal production plan. Zulaika betulkan saya kalau saya salah eh. Zulaika tanya kenapa kena ada assumption the amount of sales is equal to the amount of production. Maknanya whatever that we produce we actually sell them. Maknanya kalau kita buat 10 mesti jual 10. Kalau kita buat 100 mesti jual 100. Padahal in real life tak semestinya kan. You buat 100 mungkin jual 80 je, maknanya ada closing inventory, right? But why for limiting factor analysis, we assume they must be the same? The answer is because, ini I dah share dengan Zulaika lah, and thank God Zulaika faham, Alhamdulillah. Sebab kita, the idea of OPP guys, optimal production plan, kan? Nak buat A berapa, B berapa, C berapa. The idea of OPP is that you want to make sure that this is the highest contribution that you will get. So you akan jual yang the most profitable product dulu lah kan, buat A dulu, ada ada lagi resource buat B, ada lagi resource barulah buat C. Kalau tak cukup pun separuh C pun tak apa, macam tu kan. Kenapa kita nak rank? Sebab kita nak highest contribution. Tetapi kalau you buat penat-penat, you dah ikut ranking dah tapi tak semua terjual, tak jadi highest contribution juga. Ha, sebab itulah assumption tu should be that every amount that you produce you sell, you sold that, right? The amount of sales is equal to the amount of production. Or in other words, everything that you produce, you sold, all of them. Assumption itu explanation dia. Supaya you dapat highest contribution yang you nak itu. Yang di yang disebut di dalam OPP lah, Optimum Production Plan. It's a very good question, I believe. So, itu maksud saya, maknanya benda tu, saya tak pernahlah jumpa soalan pasir ke apa yang tanya soalan macam tu tau. Tapi bila kawan ni tanya, maknanya you nak tahu, which is a good attitude. Okay, habis. Oh, last, sebelum saya terlupa, our gentleman, Zul, ada Zul?
Ada, sir.
Excellent. Okay guys, dah, Alhamdulillah, we keep the motivation high. I hope semua orang not only motivated untuk pass, tetapi motivated to help each other. I don't think we can do this alone. At least you ada seorang atau dua kawan dalam kelas, ataupun tak tahu, mungkin from college lain yang buat PM juga, yang boleh study sama-sama lah kan, ataupun boleh support each other. Kena ada kan. Kalau macam I pun, to be honest with you, I jenis yang study sama-sama juga sebenarnya. I suka datang kelas, I suka discuss dengan kawan-kawan, tapi at the end of the day, I need my own personal time. Macam itulah. So, setiap orang ada cara belajar yang berbeza. Itu tak dinafikan. Tak perlu nak takut-takut, tak perlu nak bimbang-bimbang. Masing-masing ada style masing-masing. Tetapi, it's good to have buddy kan? Buddy, teman belajar. Macam tu. Supaya kalau kita malas, kawan kita marah kita kan? Kalau dia pula malas, kita marah dia. Kena tu kan? So, Alhamdulillah. Itu yang buat ta'awanu alal birri wat taqwa juga kan. Tolong-menolong. Kalau kita belajar bahasa Arab kan, apa tafa'ul kan, saling kan, dia punya fi'il itu membawa maksud saling. Dia buat, kita pun buat, saling membantu. Bukannya seorang je kan. Ta'awan. Anyway, semalam kita dah habis kan. As in the three is, I hope you remember, value for money. Siapa ada soalan tanya terus eh. Sebelum kita masuk chapter yang terakhir, sekejap, tapi saya pergi sikit. Like I told you, the most important part of the chapter, maybe not the most important lah, tapi the one that I think could be asked as a long question. Bukan yang nak kata yang lain tak penting, jangan salah faham eh. Cuma I highlight chapter 21 ni, VFM itu. Value for money, VFM itu. Yang mana bila sebutnya VFM, you ingat 3E kan? Economy, efficiency dan apa, effectiveness, objective, efektif kan, yang tu penting, tetapi tak menafikan yang lain pun penting. Kita tengok sikit eh. So I think to be fair to you, let's go there. I think page 470 dah eh, ke tak sampai ke, dah terlajak lah. Dah terlajak, okey jap. 466 jap eh. Yang ni. Okay, semalam kan, I think I stop here. If I remember correctly eh. So we have economy, efficiency and effectiveness. I hope you remember that economy is about cost and quality. Kita nak jimat, kita nak saving. Okay, tetapi dalam masa yang sama, we don't want to compromise, bahasa Inggeris ni. We don't want to compromise the quality. Okay, that's economy. And then efficiency is about the relationship between how much input do we use and how much output that comes from the input. So dia mesti ada relationship. And then effectiveness adalah objective, yani apa matlamat akhir, apa output yang kita nak, or getting things done kan, nak student pass. So pass ke tak student tu, is it completed or not, is it, do we achieve or not, macam tu eh. Sebenarnya tiga-tiga tu ada persoalan, do we achieve or not kan? Do we achieve the saving kan? Penjimatan tu dapat ke tak? Do we achieve the efficiency? Maknanya betul tak untuk seorang lecturer sepatutnya boleh lahirkan 20 student yang pass? Kalau less than that, dikira tak efficient lecturer tu. Contohlah kan? So semua tu kita nak achieve lah. Cuma benda akhir yang kita nak achieve tu dipanggil effectiveness. Let's move on to the next page. So dia kata apa? These are sometimes referred to as three E's. More formal definitions are as follows. Okay, tadi bagus juga kan, BPP dia bagi macam satu, I would say macam layman's term kan, spending money carefully kan, getting out as much as possible for what goes in. Dia macam sempoi sikit kan, getting things done, right? But a more formal definitions are as follows, right? Economy is attaining the appropriate quantity and quality of inputs at the lowest cost. This is nice. I think I love the definition. I told you how mantiq plays a role kan in our life, not only in Islam, in our life. Ilmu-ilmu yang diajar dalam Islam guys, what I find about our Islamic civilization, it's not only for rituals like solat, which is very important, masha Allah, very important, and the first thing to be asked adalah solat, of course. Tetapi lebih daripada itu, dia adalah tentang kehidupan. Macam mana kita belajar accounting, belajar tentang perniagaan. Diajar dalam Islam ataupun dikuasai oleh ulama Islam dan disampaikan. Contohnya ilmu mantiq. Kan? So anyway, let me not go there kan. But, nak kata di sini cantik dia punya definisi itu. Dia ada tiga benda kan. In fact, I sebut itu dua benda. Kita nak jimat sejimat-jimat yang mungkin. Dalam masa yang sama, kita nak maintain quality dan quantity. Kan? You nak kahwin nanti, nak jemput 500 orang. Boleh tak nak jimat sikit? Kurangkan kos pada separuh. Boleh. Tetapi kurangkan kos tu separuh, maka orang yang kita jemput daripada 500, kita nak jemput 250 orang je. Itu tak cantik lah. Sebab kita still nak jemput 500, kuantiti tu sama. Kualiti pun bagus. Dalam masa yang sama nak jimat kos. Itu cerita dia kan. Without compromising both quantity and quality. Kan? Dia tak kata, lagi satu guys, kalau you nak catat dalam your textbook, ni cara berfikir kita. Dia tak kata, is attaining the best, walaupun it depends on how you define it. Kalau dia kata the best, atau bukan, okay, bukan the best. The highest quantity and quality. Oh, susahlah macam tu kan? Maksudnya, kalau highest quality, mesti mahal lah. Mesti mahal lah. So, kita nak kata apa ni? Kita tak nak yang murah, yang quality entah apa-apa. Dan masa yang sama, kalau quality yang tinggi, siapa tak nak? Tapi mahal. So, kita ambil quality yang just appropriate. Nampak tak? Dia taklah teruk kualiti dia, tapi dia okay, satisfying, okay, memuaskan hati. Dalam masa yang sama, dia taklah mahal sangat. I harap you dapat gambaran tu. So, appropriate quantity and quality. And then, efficiency is the relationship between inputs and outputs. As simple as that. You ada input, you ada output, apa relationship dia? The number of students pass per lecturer. Number of goods delivered per dispatch, dispatch person. Berapa barang yang dihantar daripada setiap seorang mat dispatch, tukang hantar yang kita ada kan. Tak tahu apa istilah dia kan, mat dispatch bunyi macam rendah sikit kan, but no, they play a lot of role. At that point, I also want to tell you that antara pemikiran masyarakat moden termasuk orang Islam adalah menganggap Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam adalah sebagai postman. Nabi datang, post dekat kita, ni Al-Quran, ni sunnah, dah, bye-bye. No. The scholar say Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he himself is the post, if you will. Postman, dia hantar barang, dan kira kita kata terima kasih dekat dia, habis saya cerita kan, kita nak barang tu, kita bukan nak postman. Nabi Muhammad bukan macam tu, ada orang difikir macam tu. Salah, sebab tu akhirnya Al-Quran dengan hadis tu, dia faham ikut kepala dia kan, Nabi Muhammad ditinggalkan, tak boleh lah. Nabi Muhammad himself, he is the one yang dihantar untuk kita. Sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Itu cerita, tapi saya harap saya beritahu lah kan, kita nak jadi accountant dan kita nak jadi orang Islam yang baik. I hope, I am also trying to learn to do that. Anyway, effectiveness, ni habislah. Effective, objective. Is the relationship between the organization's outputs and its objectives. As in, output yang you dapat tu, capai tak objektif kita, itu je lah. Dah, jom kita tengok konteks sikit. Imagine a bottle of washing up liquid for cleaning dishes. Okay. We'll call it angel dishes. Okay. The advertising says angel dishes is good value for money because it washes twice as many plates as any other washing up liquid. Kan? Kadang-kadang macam sabun kan? Sampai kena guna dua sudu. Tapi kalau yang ini sangat bagus. Guna satu sudu pun dah cukup. So value for money lah tu. Jimat kan? Bottle for bottle, it may be more expensive. But plate for plate, it is cheaper. Maksudnya katakanlah, I think you faham kan maksud dia? Kalau you beli satu botol yang angel dishes ni, harga dia katakanlah RM20 sebotol. Berbanding dengan you beli satu yang jenama X yang tak berapa berkualiti lah. Satu tu lagi murah, RM15 je. RM15 je. Macam tu kan? Macam tu ke? So, kalau dengan RM20 ni, you boleh basuh katakanlah 100 pinggan. 100 plates, right? Tetapi dengan satu ni, satu Allahumma salli alaihi, X ni, jenama X ni, you boleh basuh hanya 50 pinggan. Nampak tak guys? Bottle by bottle, you beli satu bottle angel dishes, RM20, $20. You beli satu bottle of X, $15, kan? Nak katanya lagi murah, bottle to bottle, dia lagi mahal, $20 kan. Tetapi $20 tu boleh basuh 100 pinggan sebab dia macam pekat lah contoh kan. Berbanding dengan ni adalah 50 pinggan je. Kan? So you kena beli dua kalau you nak basuh 100 pinggan. So dari segi Ha, dari segi plate kita lagi banyak lah. Yang pertama, yang kedua, kalau katakanlah nak compare apple to apple kan, kalau nak gunakan Angel Dishes dengan brand X untuk basuh 100 pinggan, akhirnya kita perlukan ni dua botol, akhirnya lagi mahal lah, 15 campur 15 kan 30. Saya harap you faham maksudnya. Kan, botol per botol dia lagi mahal tapi dia sebenarnya lagi efektif. Ha, begitu. Ha, kan? But plate for plate, it is cheaper. Ha. Not only this, but Angel Dishes gets plates squeaky clean. I like that word. Squeaky ni, Allahumma salli alaihi. Benda dalam bahasa yang menarik adalah vocab ataupun perbendaharaan kata yang tentang bunyi kan. Macam apa ya? Burung berkicau kan. Apa angin mendayu-dayu macam tu kan. Ayam berkokok, anything saya ada lah. Tapi squeaky ni macam macam mana ya? Macam kalau you buka pintu tu kan dia bergesa macam macam tu kan. So nak katanya licin kan yang you macam tu kan. Tak apalah kan. Kenapa nak kena explain yang tu tak masuk exam kan. Kerana ada squeaky, I think that's the sound that it makes. Nak kata licinnya dia. To summarize, Angel Dishes gives us VFM, value for money, because it inhibits, it exhibits the following characteristic. Okay. Dia capai objektif. Apa dia? Kita nak pinggan bersih. Bukan setakat bersih, siap boleh bunyi lagi. Macam tu kan? Tak kisahlah bunyi macam ni. Squeak kan? Nanti you Google lah. You Google jangan Google makna dia. Google bunyi dia. Boleh. Sekarang Google macam-macam kan? More clean plates per squirt ni setiap kali you picit, dia keluar satu kan? Picit sekali dah boleh basuh dua pinggan. Berbanding brand biasa, you picit sekali, satu pinggan pun tak boleh basuh. Kena picit kali kedua baru. Macam tu lah. Faham kan? Sebab tu ada perkataan per tu. And then ekonomi pun ada tentang saving lah kan. More clean plates per dollar spent. Itu ekonomi. Clean maknanya quality, dalam masa yang sama dollar tu taklah mahal seperti mana yang lain. I harap itu dah jadi satu benda yang clear untuk kita lah. Settle kan? Ingat kan VFM ni basically untuk not for profit organisation. Okay, biasanya sebab dia orang bukannya they don't want to maximize profit, or at least that's not the main idea, the main objective. Therefore, biasanya kita akan pakai VFM. Okay, saya contoh. Okay, contoh latihan eh. Which two of the following performance measures would be appropriate for measuring effectiveness for a public sector higher education college? Ingat tau, apa dia ni? Sekarang public sector nampak? Maknanya macam UITM Shah Alam, Universiti Awam, IPTA kan? Dan dia kata nak measure effectiveness. Okay, so I think you know that teaching hours per student is I don't think that's objective kan. Itu could be apa, maybe I think I would put under efficiency kan. And then sourcing lecturers of appropriate quality at an acceptable cost, this is, I think that's quite clear. That should be, I pula yang jawab kan, that should be economy. Kalau you tak setuju ataupun kalau you ada idea lain, kalau kata tak setuju nanti you tak berani pula jawab kan. Takkan saya tak setuju dengan saya pula kan. Saya takut fikir macam tu, padahal okey je kita berbincang. So kalau you ada idea lain, you beritahu. Yang ketiga, percentage of graduates employed within 12 months of the course ending. Oh okay, that sounds like, dia minta dua eh. Okay. So that sounds like it kan. And the percentage of students achieving target, oh, ni very obvious lah. Dua-dua ni adalah objektif kita dekat college. So do you agree guys, the last two would be the answers, ataupun you agree ke you tak agree ke, tiba-tiba jawapan je kat belakang. Itu tak jawapan dia, the last two. Any question there, any arguments? Yes eh, okay good, thank you Azim. Okay eh? Itu jawapan eh, the last two kan. So if you you know agree, then the first one tu I would consider that efficiency, the second is economy, and the last two are effectiveness. Dah habis set up. Okay, jom kita wrap up yang ni sebelum kita kejap je rasa 40 minit tu. Cuba saya cakap banyak eh. Sorry guys eh. Kita masuk chapter baru in the next link nanti eh. Kita habiskan terus ni chapter ni in about 9 minutes. Non-financial performance indicators. In chapter 19, ratio analysis tu lah. Kan yang kita belajar building block model, balance scorecard. We covered NFPRs and their value. These aspects can be applied to the public sector also. Okay? Kena faham bahasa. Bukan hanya untuk public sector, tetapi boleh digunakan untuk public sector. Itu satu kan, antara public sector dengan private sector. Lagi ingat tak, kita bincang juga pasal product business dengan service business. Building block model is very suitable for service business. Very suitable, tapi bukannya only for service business. Bukan, kena faham betul-betul. As with profit-seeking businesses, NFPO, not-for-profit organizations, can measure quality, efficiency, delivery, semua ni, selalu dipanggil non-financial kan, customer satisfaction and innovation. VFM and the three E's, therefore, include performance measures which are non-financial. Include lah, include, mana termasuk di dalam tu. Dia tak nafikan yang financial, tetapi dia include juga yang non-financial. Dia tidak nafikan financial, tetapi di include juga yang non-financial. Kita tengok. Guys, nanti kan, saya cadangkan lah kan, you ada sama-sama rehat makan biskut ke apa kan. tak, saya gelap tu sebab saya terfikir setengah orang kata sama-sama relax, isap okok kan. Jangan isap okok eh, insyaAllah. Saya pun Alhamdulillah, I don't smoke. But anyway, sama-sama rehat tu kan, cuba belik-belik sekejap kan. Cari muka surat yang ada exam focus point je. Sebab it tells you, it exposes you to something very related to exam itself. Kalau you, akhirnya kita nak pergi exam kan? So apa yang berkait betul directly tentang exam? Ni antaranya. Performance management questions regularly appear as a constructed response question, maknanya session C lah, in the exam. Ha, memang lah kan, dia kata regularly, memang sepatutnya keluar. Ha. Therefore, you must be comfortable discussing this area and applying your knowledge to the scenario in the question. Nampak? Bukan jawab dia, you kena explain, you kena discuss. Ha, eh? And apply, maknanya as in, you kena apa? Relate dengan scenario. You may be given numbers relating to financial or non-financial indicators and you must be able to talk about them. Be confident guys. You dah, kalau you dah belajar, dan of course you dah belajar kan, itu yang you buat sekarang. So you kena be confident. Jangan biarkan, auzubillah minasyaitanirrajim, jangan biarkan syaitan mewaswaskan diri kita. Kan? Alladhi yuwaswisu fi sudurin nas, tu kan? Bacalah tiga kul. You may be given numbers relating, the examining team have said that. Tengok-tengok, bila dia kata examining team kan, maknanya ini orang yang akan tanda ketah ke nanti. Apa komen dia? Kita nak dengar ni. Dia orang yang nak bagi makar kita nanti. Have said that subtracting one number from another is not enough. Ha, ini saya dah beritahu gitu. You ada discussion mark, you ada calculation mark. Sekadar tolak je dapat tak markah? Not enough, dia kata. Ha, ni maknanya bukan air kira-kira eh. Memang dia kata. Ha, maknanya kena buat dalam percentage. For example, if the number of complaints received one year was 50 and the next year was 60, ya, nampak? Oh, maknanya bertambah 10. Jangan. As in, tu tak salah. Tapi tak dapat markah. Tak layak dapat markah. It would not be sufficient to simply say that there were 10 more complaints. See, you must take the percentage increase in complaints in order to earn marks, which is the, which in this case, which, silap sikit ni. Oh, sorry, betul lah. Which is this case, okay. Which in kan guys? Which, sorry, I selalu disturbed by grammar. Which in this case would be a 20% increase. Dah, settle. Okay, kita dah ulang dah benda tu. Ini ulangan dia. Dia dah sebut benda tu. Target setting in qualitative areas, 5 minit. In chapter 19, section 9, we discuss the difficulties of measuring non-financial aspects of performance. The same problems arise for not-for-profit and public sector organizations. Problems include selecting a suitable measure for performance. Again, suitable measure maknanya nak ukur macam mana eh? Customer suka ke tak? Ha, macam tu kan? Benda ni guys, itu yang kita kata sebelum ni. Okay, dengar. Apa dia yang kita kata? You will not only calculate, you will have to explain. Number one. Number two, why is this called the subject? Why is it called performance management? Because you do not only measure performance, but you manage how you measure performance. In other words, you bukan sahaja belajar, I dah bagi tahu kan, cara nak guna building block, balance scorecard, cara oh ini financial, cari benda-benda berbentuk financial. Customer, cari benda yang berbentuk customer. Maknanya you kira lah. Itu satu. Tetapi you kena measure the measurement itself. You kena tengok, eh, kalau balance kau kata customer, bagus tak eh? Aspek customer ni bagus tak? Oh, bagus lah sebab customer yang bagi kita duit. Oh, contoh yang lain, bukan sahaja you ada tukul dan gergaji dan pahat untuk you buat rumah. You pandai buat rumah, so itu satu. Tapi you pandai tak pilih alat. Oh, pahat ni macam besar sangat, tak sesuai. Kena pahat yang kecil sikit sebab kita nak buat satu hasil yang halus. Tukul ni berat sangat. Kena tukul yang kayu lah, tak nak tukul yang besi. That means you don't only use it to make the house, to build the house, but you also talk about the tools that you use. So apart from measuring the performance of the company, you are measuring the performance tool, the measuring tools. Harap you faham yang itu. Sebab tadi dia kata selecting a suitable measure for performance. Not necessarily correctly measuring the performance. Tetapi pilih measurement yang betul. I harap you faham. It's a higher level. Okay. Having data which by its very nature is not quantified. Yang tak ada problem ni lah. A lack of system for collecting data. Ini lagi satu kan. Macam saya dah bagi tahu semalam. Kalau contoh paling mudah bagi I lah. Kalau benda yang berbentuk quantity. Quantity, financial, nombor, benda tu kan direcord dalam financial statement. Dan ada dokumen kan, kita panggil apa eh? Yelah, your books of prime entry, semua tu kan? Kan ada record, invoice semua. Tetapi benda-benda macam customer suka kan? You record ke tak benda tu? Mungkin ada lah kot kan? Mungkin setiap kali customer datang, especially I think you pun tahu kan ada membership kan? Kalau restoran dia ada membership, so bila dibayar tu dia masukkan nombor dia ke apa ke, tapi kita boleh record lah, oh, dia ni dah datang ni kali ke 10 lah, ataupun pattern dapat setiap bulan sekali mungkin dapat gaji dia datang sini kot. So bila ada data tu, you tahu bila customer tu is a repeat customer, tak, maknanya dia satisfied. So certain areas ada data, tapi tak semua yang ada kan. Kalau katakan you nak ukur dari segi senyuman kan, kita yang on the field, you adalah waiter contoh kan, kita bagi makanan, kita nampak dia senyum, kita boleh beritahu bos, dalam meeting bos, saya rasa customer kita suka, saya nampak semua orang makan dengan lahapnya, siapa tak baca bismillah pun ada, contoh kan, itu tak apalah, and then nampak senyum, nampak enjoy sampai sehingga menjilat jari kan, KFC punya talent. Nak kata apa ni, nak kata daripada situ, kita buat conclusion, customer are satisfied, tapi, macam mana nak record benda tu? Adakah dalam restoran tu ada CCTV yang record every smile of customer? Kalau pun ada dan customer tahu, mesti dia tak datang dah sebab tak ada privacy kan. So I hope you get my point. Benda yang berbentuk kualitatif ni, satisfaction and so on, mungkin susah sikit nak collect data. Bukan tak boleh tau, sebab tu dia kata lack of system, susah, kurang sistem untuk collect the data. And ada isu short termism lah. Yang benda ni kita dah belajar kan. Okay, sekejap, ada soalan ke? Kejap eh. Soalan daripada Mas Liza. Untuk VFM, boleh guna untuk ratio interpretation juga lah kan. But for an FPO. Boleh guna untuk ratio interpretation juga. But for an FPO. Well, if I understand you correctly, Mas Liza, kalau maksud you adalah sebagaimana ratio analysis tu kita gunakan untuk profit seeking company, maka itulah juga cara kita measure performance of an FPO. Tetapi an FPO kita tak pakai ratio analysis, kita pakai VFM. If that is your question, then yes, correct. Maknanya lain orang, lain jenis organisasi, lain cara kita evaluate dia. Walaupun mungkin VFM kalau nak apply dekat profit seeking, I think bagi I boleh je. Kalau ditanya I lah kan. Cuma VFM ni lebih-lebih lagi sesuai untuk not for profit organisation. So ibarat VFM for NFPO and then ratio analysis for the rest. Macam tu. Okay, good Mas Liza. Okay guys, so I think by right we are done with this. Maybe I sentuh 2 minit then kita masuk chapter baru. Okay, I'm gonna give you another link. Take a few minutes break lah, 1-2 minutes break, and then bagi link yang baru. Thank you everyone.